There's a town deep in the vastness of the Mojave Desert, not far from Badwater Basin and Death Valley, as the crow flies. It's named Ballarat. It was the home of Seldom Seen Slim for much of his life.
I am 3.5 miles away from our ultimate destination, Ballarat.
But this is why we came here.
To get there, all you gotta do is drive down a road that ain't worth paving, past some weird radar thing, and eventually you'll spot some crumbling adobe. The place ain't what it used to be. So before we get into the details about one Charles Ferge, oh, that's Seldom Seen Slim's real name, by the way, let me tell you about what this place once was. Ballarat's roots go way back to 1849, when a nearby spot known as Post Office Springs was a scarce source of water in an otherwise inhospitable environment. The area became a generally well-known place that early explorers and prospectors would gather. In the 1890s, there was a boom at nearby Panamint City. It would have generated excitement and prospectors would have flooded to the area. Those folks had their needs, including supplies and a place to kick back and relax. So it would follow that a town sprang up to service the people. And that's really Ballarat's roots. Former watering hole turned into a mining town. Ballarat's golden years spanned from 1897 to 1905. By 1900, the town had a post office, several hotels, and double the saloons. About 500 people called this place home. Things cruised along through the early 1900s, then mining in the area began a steady decline. In very short order, Ballarat lost its relevance and most folks moved away, save for a few holdouts and desert rats. One such example, Shorty Harris, the guy who founded the famous bullfrog claim that spawned the town of Rhyolite, called Ballarat home in his later years. Guys like this lived for free in the town's now abandoned buildings. Talk about off-the-grid living. But Ballarat seemed to be the last holdout for the most hardcore of old-time prospectors, the last of a dying breed. Then in 1917 or thereabouts, Mr. Charles Ferge became the last permanent resident of a town left to time.
So Murray's book says that Slim was basically the police chief, fire chief, mayor, everything of this town. And people would come by and visit his trailer. And apparently he was very welcoming and would tell people stories of the old days. But like I said, I think that's the trick. He seems to have probably met hundreds or thousands of vacationers probably coming through, I'm gonna guess in the 1950s when people were really obsessed with the Old West and things like that. And they found an old prospector out here that had many tales. Probably talked about Tonopah and the Silver Rush and the Gold Rushes of Nevada and those exciting times. And to people of the 40s, 50s, and 60s, it probably would have been fascinating. And it's just so bad. It's just so sad that there's really not much else documented. I couldn't find any video, couldn't find anything. So once again, I just think it's a very anecdotal thing that, you know, was strong enough for people to carry forward his name into the future. Here's one of the ruined buildings. I don't know if we're gonna get any info about what these buildings were.
It's always energizing to make real connections to the past. Take this building for example. Although I didn't realize it at the time, some years back our buddy Slim was hanging out right there. It's a bit alarming to see how fast the adobe melts away. Left unattended, I would not be surprised if almost nothing is left by the end of the century. Perhaps the rusted ore carts and other mining implements will better stand the test of time. But if you know where to look, there's still a hidden treasure or two to be found in this old town.
I've heard of this building. This was the Ballarat Jail, and it also served as a morgue. And the date on that is 1898, so I'm assuming this is an original structure. I'm inside this old wooden jail slash morgue. Wow. Wow. It smells old. Hear that wood creaking? Lots of graffiti on the wall. People have carved their initials all over the place.
Some kind of a bed, an old piece of furniture in here, and a view. Imagine this wouldn't have been here in the days of the jail, would it? That wouldn't have made much sense. Wonder if Slim ever slept in here or used this. I'm sure he did. I'm sure he was in here playing. It's a very nice structure. Oh wow, look at this. You could see like a square head nail. So that's a sign of a different time, the 1800s. Here's another square head nail. They don't make them like that anymore. Now they've got round nails like so. I'm just listening to the building as I walk. It's strange. Maybe they brought canaries into the mines. Who knows? So hey, old Slim, if you're here around still, floating in the ether, I'm here to discover your secrets. I hope you're okay with that. I know you were pretty tight-lipped about your life and didn't like to talk about yourself, but all I hear is just the creaking of boards underneath my feet.
There were a couple other neat finds in current-day Ballarat. There's a modern building where I hear a caretaker sometimes offers cold drinks and tells tales, but I guess today was a slow day and not worth coming out. I'll have to come back and pick his brain about Slim in this town someday, but out in front were a few interesting relics.
And here's some old, looks like parts of cars, engines, stuff that old Slim almost certainly was the caretaker of. Not sure if he used the stuff, but I do know he had some kind of transportation because he'd had to drive into other towns to get supplies and things. Is it possible that one of these is just old trucks like this here?
Now what I find humorous in a slightly dark way is I didn't realize at the time that this truck was owned by the Manson family.
Good, really cool thing. Old Slim, is this your old truck? Seeing if I could smell the past.
Yeah, Charles Manson almost certainly rode in this thing. It was abandoned by Tex Watson when the truck broke down as he fled the law. He was departing nearby Barker Ranch, a hideout for Manson and his followers.
Now it makes sense. His name, Seldom Seen Slim. I mean, if you live out here, I don't know if seldom seen is even like a good word, like never seen.
If you did a bit of research about Slim, you'd quickly hear about how he was known to bathe only when an occasional rain passed through the desert. Some say he never bathed. Upon studying some of his photos, I can believe it. It's especially evident in later photos. Author Tom Murray even compares an earlier photo of Slim to a later one, and subtly points out that in a short span of years, later Slim seems a little malnourished. I think he puts it a little lightly. But then again, Slim lived a longer life than most. He'd come a long way from the days of booming Tonopah, the railroads, the excitement. The people came to reflect on those times in 1967 during an event named Ballarat Days, where the Trona High School band played to a crowd of onlookers, among them a frail-looking Slim, certainly in his final days, suffering from cancer. I wonder what he was thinking as he watched the show. Did he reflect on the old times? Just bury me where the digging's easy. That seems to sum it all up. And wouldn't you know it, Ballarat's got a cemetery named Boot Hill too. It's a real Old West ghost town. At age 86, Mr. Charles Ferge, our dear friend Seldom Seen Slim, passed away of cancer at Trona Hospital, some 70 miles away from home. He was the first person in over a quarter of a century to be buried in Ballarat's little minor cemetery, the 28th grave, the last man living in Ballarat. And with his passing, one of the few remaining windows to the past was shut forever. All of the stories of the olden days, the word of mouth, gone, never to be heard again. With those connections forever severed, we now have to pick through the scraps to piece together our tales. Thankfully, people like Tom Murray took the time to document what little he did. For someone who didn't want people to fuss, about 350 people attended Slim's funeral. Seemed to be quite the event. How many of us will be able to say the same one day?
So the folks here in Ballarat, you all were pioneers, prospectors. I would love to have gone back and experienced what you guys did back in that day, the sense of freedom, the sense of adventure.
As I wandered around Boot Hill, I recognized the names of many people from my research. Slim was buried in the company of friends, fellow rainbow chasers, dreamers. Just like all of his contemporaries in the town before this one, and the one before that, all the way back to Tonopah. We've traveled hundreds of miles to come to this moment, when we finally come face to face with a man whose life's path we traced. And while you may think the lengths I went to tell this man's tale are a bit much, I'll have you consider this. He's got a mountain peak named after him. Yes, you're reading that right. He had a book written about him by our friend Mr. Murray. And in his time in Ballarat, nobody told him what to do. And best of all, his epitaph reads, "Me lonely? Hell no. I'm half coyote and half wild burro."
So Slim, you don't know me, and I don't really know you that well because there's not much information about you. You seem to not like to talk about yourself, but something about the little bits and pieces I could pick up about you made me want to come see what you saw through your own eyes, to come find out why would someone choose to live alone in a desolate place like this? Why would someone spend their whole life chasing rainbows, so to speak? Are you able to tell me what the secret is, what your secret is? I don't know, what do you guys think? I think he represents freedom, hope, the dream that we all want to live, having control of your life and your destiny, not letting anybody tell you what to do or where to go or how to live. That's what this is about. That is what I am fascinated with. The bravery that it would take to live and choose to live that way. I don't think most of us got that in us now, but these people did.